So yesterday I explained how you can relate the what I did yesterday. I explained the relations between three objects: the edge-reinforced random walk that I defined in the first course, the vertex-reinforced jump process that I defined yesterday, and this measure that I recalled there, this sigma model. So let me remind that it was this formula. So just to briefly recall what I explained yesterday. So you have this formula, so that the U is so you are you have a graph G with vertex V and edge E, and assume that you have positive conductances on the edges. And so this measure lives on the field. The UI are reals on the vertices, and in this expression, it's rooted at one point, which is the starting point of the VRGB. Okay, so the U is rooted at value zero at I dot in this expression. Okay, and what I explained yesterday is that this vertex reinforced jump process in a good time scale, it's a mixture of Markov jump process with rate 1/2 of Wij exponential UG minus UI, where U follows this this loop. Okay, so what it means is that this process that I defined yesterday, this self-interacting process, reinforced process, you can describe it by first picking the field according to this distribution, and then running the Markov chains with this jump process, with this jump rate. Okay, so that's what I explained yesterday. So let me now, what I would like to do today, first I will state the localization and delocalization result of this of Disertori-Spencer and Zernbauer and Disertori-Spencer for this measure. So the history is that they, so okay, they were, I will explain later where it comes from, but they first prove a delocalization result for this this measure, which somehow is more difficult, I think, than the localization. But so that's the work of Disertori, Spencer, and Zernbauer. So it's from 2006. And it says that, suppose that, okay, for simplicity, suppose that we are on ZD. Okay, and you take Wij equal to W constant. Okay? And, okay, so that's not a finite graph. This formula is only true for a finite graph. But if you take a box, lambda in ZD, then what they proved, okay, no, sorry. Let me first state the, okay, let me first state the localization result. I always started by the localization, which appeared after. So what they proved in this paper of Disertori and Spencer is that you have localization of the field, you have an exponential decrease of the field when W is small enough. So it means strong reinforcement. So, for any D, there exists a value W that depends on the dimension, such that if W is smaller than W inf, then there exists a constant C, such that you have exponential decrease of some moment of the field, So suppose that I naught is equal to zero. Okay, so you start at the origin. And in this case, for the moment, the moment 1/2, then this is smaller than some constant times the infinite norm of g. Okay, so you have exponential decrease in the distance to the origin of the 1/2 exponential moment of u. Okay, this is not true for any s there. Okay, for example, if you take s equal 1, in this case it's always equal to 1. In fact, it comes from this form. Okay.
What is u?
Okay. So u represent. Okay. Excuse me. That's the expectation with respect to this measure. On lambda. Okay. My notation are not very good, but it's clear.
What can I?
That's a j is a point in the box. Okay, so you look at the field at this point, you take the expectation with respect to, okay, let me write it in this way. That's the expectation with respect to the measure mu 0 w in the box lambda. Okay, so that's uniform in the box lambda. This constant does not depend on the box lambda, and you have exponential decrease. Yes?
Is there a way to see from that formula that this will happen?
That this will happen?
Yeah, just heuristically, you know, without. Okay, you can see that whole hyperbolic cosine, for example, that's kind of an attraction term, right?
Yes, okay, this term is responsible for the fact that you should be delocalized, I guess.
Rigid. It's rigid defies.
So I think the localization comes from the. It's not easy to see intuitively in the formula. The localization comes from this term.
I see. If you pay the cost by uj minus ui squared, like Gaussian precision.
Yes, but then it's not delocalized.
It's delocalized.
Yes. So the localization comes from this term. In fact, if you think that it's a tree, then this term will give only one. It will be a product. Because if the graph is a tree, then you have only one spanning tree there. So the graph is a product. So you have the product. You can write it as the product of the grad. There's a way to write it as the product of the grad. And then you have this term also that pushes everything down. So you want exponential decrease, but then you have to match with the fact that you should not grow too much. So it depends. That's type of competition between this that wants that the field stabilize, and this term that. This term and this is an effect of the routing that wants that the field decreases far from the origin. But it's not easy to see on the. Okay, I will give later. I will not give, but there's a way to write a formula of delocalization of localization, exactly as the proof of Simone Wartzel last week. About a fractional moment bound for random Schrödinger apparatus. Okay. So that's the localization part, and then they also proved a second result, which is the delocalization, which appears before. Okay, of course, they were more interested in the delocalization than in the localization, because this model was a toy model for some sigma field that is related to Anderson. So Localization is more delocalization is more attractive than localization, which is clear on for Anderson model. But nevertheless, their proof is, this proof is quite tricky in the way they write it. There's another way to write it, but it's, their proof is very quite tricky. Okay, so the localization delocalization result, it's okay. We are still on ZD, same condition, so it's constant. But now we suppose that D is larger than 3, then there exists another value. I don't call it critical value because we this value will not match. We don't know that these two values match. Okay, we have not sharp transition such that for all M. Okay, no, I should. Sorry, I should. Excuse me. So for all m positive, there exists a critical value that depends on d and m, such that you have a very good control on the fluctuation of the field. More precisely, if you take the expectation with respect to anything, if you look at the cosh of the fluctuations of the field, okay, so it's minus u0, but u0 is equal to 0, so you don't care, but okay, no, sorry. It's for any ig. So you look at the fluctuation of the field at any distance, then to power m, then this is smaller than something which in their case is 2. Okay? So you have very good control on the moments of the cosh of the fluctuations. Okay, so why the cosh? It's because we are interested, in fact, what we are interested in is in the exponential. We are interested in these type of things, exponential ug minus ui at distance. Okay, so the cosh gives you a very good control both on this and on its inverse for any moments. I mean, for any moments you can get good control for, okay, if w is larger than this value. Okay. So that's a delocalization. It means that if you look at the if you look at the field exponential ug, then it will be not will be something that the I mean this field is not too big, not too small, and okay, it's positive, so. Okay, so that's delocalization. And from this, okay, it's clear, the statement? So this is far from being a trivial result. It's a difficult multiscale analysis. I would say one word, but not too much because it's very difficult. And so from that, it's rather easy to deduce. From that, you can deduce two things. You can deduce for the vertex reinforced jump process, because for the vertex reinforced jump process, you know that this is a mixture of Markov jump process with this distribution, with this jumping rate. So it means that if you look at the discrete path, if you look at the discrete Markov chain associated with the VRJP, then it's a, okay, so the discrete VRJP is a reversible Markov chain with conductances Wij exponential ui plus uj. Okay, if you want it to be symmetric, then you need to multiply by the invariant measure, which is exponential 2 ui. So, okay, so it means that if you have exponential decrease of this, it gives exponential decrease of the conductances and it gives localization of the VRJP. Okay. So it means that at w small, in any dimension, it gives that the VRJP is positive recurrent. Okay. Exactly as for the okay, that's the same as for the ERRW, what I explained the first day. And now it says also that that dimension d larger than 3, w large. Then it's not difficult to so what does it give this? This gives the fact that this conductance has some okay, so the second inequality tells that if you look at the conductances, then they have upper moment, okay, they have bounded moment. And if you look at 1 over the conductances, that it also have good control on the moments. Okay, so it's standard argument of Markov chains to prove that in this case it's transient. Okay, that's comparison with simple random walk, and then it means that the VRJP is transient. Okay, so that's for the VRJP. Now, from this result, you can also deduce result for the ERRW.
Sorry, can I just ask? Is this reversible Markov chain? This is the time change one?
Okay, so that's discrete. So it means that I don't care about the time. Yeah. If you look just at the discrete time process, then it's... yes. So now, for the ERRW, in fact, it's... so if you see that if you want to have similar result for the ERRW, you need to have some estimates, but taking expectation with respect to random W. Okay, so there are two cases for the localization. So it means that you need to prove that if you take W random and you integrate according to the W, which are IID, then you get similar estimate. Okay. In fact, for this case, it's rather easy to adapt the argument. So it gives similar similar result. So we have from this we can also deduce. Okay, so what I mean is that after it's easy to adapt the argument to take expectation with respect to W. So it gives ERRW is positive recurrent for a small enough. Okay, so that's something we okay. We adapted the proof, but that's not difficult. And with the correspondence between these three objects, it gives also the localization of the ERW. And now it's more difficult to adapt the second part. So it's the same. You have to take W random, and you have to adapt this this estimate. And that's more work because that's a multi-scale argument. So you cannot have uniform estimates on the W. So you have to redo the proof. So that was done by Dissertori, Tares, and myself. So you can have a delocalization result for the ERRW. I don't know if it's clear. So it means that you want to have the same result, but after expectation with respect to W. Okay. So it means that the ERRW is transient for A large. On ZD, D larger or equal to 3 for A large. Large enough. Okay, so it gives yes.
So these results are actually predating the connection to reinforced random walk.
This one?
Yes.
Actually, okay, I can make a comment. In this first paper, so in this paper that appears in 2006, so they had no connection with reinforced random walk. Nevertheless, they okay, so they had this formula, and so some people suggested that it looked like the magic formula of for the ERRW. And so some people, including Cosma, Stittman, I don't know, several other people, they saw some similarities between the two objects. Okay, so it was guessed somehow, but that there could be some connections, but it was not clear whether it was a connection at the level of heuristics or similar behavior, or if there were a clear connection.
So is this how you found this VRGP, or?
No, actually we didn't know this result, in fact. So it's after that. Okay, it's Gavetsky that told us, but this measure already exists. So that was a surprise, but okay. So now what I would like to do is two things. First, I should at some point explain the relation with some type of random Schrödinger operator, otherwise I will be out of the scope of the school. So but first, I would like to say, okay, so I would like to say two words about the geometric interpretation of this measure. So let's say that it's part three. So the objective is first to say a few words about the geometric interpretation of mu. So that's how it was introduced by Disserter, Spencer, and Czernauer. And I will explain also the relation with some random Schrödinger operator. So that's more recent development on the subject. Random Schrödinger operator. Okay. So I will be very brief on that. But okay, if you look at the measure mu, then you see that you have a square root of a determinant. When you have a square root of a determinant, then what you want to do is somehow to break this square root, and the way to do that is to add a Gaussian free field. Okay, so what you have is that if you look at a Gaussian free field, what you know is that if you look at this measure, which is the Gaussian measure. Okay, you look at the Gaussian free field, so it's the Gaussian measure with this density. So you suppose that you root your Gaussian field at you root your Gaussian field at I naught. Then you know that this is equal to. Okay, so don't put this conductances, but you put the conductances ui plus ug. Okay, so you suppose that u is fixed, and you take this conductance. Okay, in this case, this is equal exactly to the square root of minus one, to the square root of this determinant. Okay, so it means that there's a way to add a second square root so that you break the square root. Okay. Just by adding a second variable, which is a Gaussian free field, but that's a Gaussian free field, but with conductances that depends on the first coordinate. Yes. So you can do that, and it gives this formula. So it gives that you have a measure that has two coordinates, du and ds, and which is the same, but you have now. You make the sum on all ij of wij. Okay, I forgot. No, okay, it's okay. Wij, and then you have a cosh. And you have ui plus ug. Then you have the square of the difference minus 1. And then you have no square root, you just have that dwu, dugs. Okay? Okay, it's clear. Just that you add this measure, so it gives an extra square root of determinant there to normalize, and so you have no square root. Okay, and now you have this term, which is the Bij. And of course, the physicists, when they see that, they want to remove also the determinant. And the way to remove the determinant is to add some antisymmetric variable to do some super antisymmetric integrals. But I will not talk about that because I will not need it really. So, but that's the second step. If you really want to write everything as a as interaction between neighbors, then you need to add some antisymmetric variables to kill the determinant. But let me, what I would like to say is just to interpret the Bij as some interaction in a hyperbolic space. I will not be I will not give the full details, but in fact you can interpret this as some scalar product in the hyperbolic plane. So interpretation of the Bij, you can define the hyperbolic space not in the in the representation of by the upper half plane, but in terms of the hyperboloid by three coordinates x, y, z. So suppose that you look at the set of x, y, z such that x squared plus y squared minus z squared is equal to minus 1. And suppose that z is positive. So it means that it's the hyperboloid, but you take the upper upper component. Yes? So that's also the what is called the hyperbolic space, but in this representation. You have also the representation in the upper half plane or the Poincaré disk and so on. And okay. So now on this space, you have a natural bilinear form, which is the Lorentzian bilinear form, just by taking x, you just symmetrize this, this quadratic form. Okay? And the only thing that I want to say is that this Bij, in fact, it corresponds to an interaction on this space with this bilinear form. So this Bij, it's equal to the scalar product of, okay, this has no meaning, but this is the scalar product, the okay, the, it's, not the it's not the scalar product, it's a bilinear form. Okay. It's a bilinear form of xi, xj, but in different coordinates. So it's written in all cycle coordinates. So what does it mean? It means that any point in this space can be represented by so if you have U and S, then you can represent. So okay, you have a formula. It's not very useful that I write it, but okay, just to state something clear. The Auroral cycle coordinate, it's a way to represent this this hyperbolic space in terms of R2 by this this okay, there's a meaning of all this, but let me not anyway, I'm not an expert, so I could say some stupid thing soon. Okay, there's a way to parameterize this hyperbolic space by R2, by the this type of change of variable, which are called the Auroral cycle coordinates. Okay, so it means that in this case, this Bij corresponds to the scalar product of these two things once you have written the x and y in the in these Auroral cycle coordinates. Yes? So why I say that, it's because you see that you have a natural interaction which has a geometric meaning. Yes?
This should be called holospherical coordinate.
No, don't think so. I think I dimension that it's spherical. Yes. Okay. So anyway,
is this just a function of the hyperbolic distance?
Excuse me?
Is this just a function of the hyperbolic distance?
Well, I think that the function of the, I think the hyperbolic distance is the arc cosh of that.
So
or something like this. So it's not exactly the hyperbolic distance, but I think it's the Arkosh of that. So it's more the interaction in terms of this Lorentzian scalar product. Okay, so you see that you have a meaning in the sense that you have a you have some space which has a natural bilinear form, and then you have interaction between the neighbors that are given by this scalar product. Okay, this is easy to see that this is also equal to the norm of it's also something like this, or minus plus minus, because the xx, if you take the scalar product of xx, it's equal to minus 1. Okay, maybe there's a plus or minus there. Okay, so you see that you have something like a distance for this. Okay, it's not the distance, but it's the norm for this bilinear form up to a constant. Yes? So you have natural interpretation of that. Okay? And then you can also add the remove this d by adding some supersymmetric coordinate, and that's the way it's presented that's the way it's reintroduced. And in this case, you have a supersymmetric version of the hyperbolic space. Okay, and in this case, you remove all the determinant, and you just have an interaction between neighbors. Okay, so why I say that is because there are some identity that comes from this interpretation, and these identities are somehow the key tool to the delocalization proof. So let me say one word about the delocalization. That will not give any concrete proof. And then I will forget all that. So if you are not if you are lost today, it's not very important. So what does it mean? In particular, it means that this variable b is important. And in fact, it's what is proved in the proof. What is in the proof of delocalization, what is proved is not only that the hyperbolic cosine of the difference to the power m is smaller than b2, but in fact, what is proved is that this b to the power m is smaller than something. And it's easier to work with this coordinate than with the CH because there are better identities. Okay? So how works the delocalization part? I will say only two words, but it's so delocalization, idea of the delocalization proof. I mean, it's less than ID, because it's so it's a multiscale argument. Which is based, so it's a multiscale argument, but the starting point of the multiscale argument is an identity which is called Ward identity. So what is the Ward identity? In fact, I don't understand what's the Ward identity in general. The way I understand it is when you have an integral. So here you see that this integral is always equal to 1. When you have such a thing, which is a non-trivial fact that this integral is equal to 1, then you can get identities by differentiating on the coefficients. Okay? And that gives you some identities that eventually could be interesting for the analysis of the measure. Okay? So
well, identities, the field theory consists in changing variables inside the integral. You change variables infinitesimally inside the integral, and the integral is not changed, but the change of variables induces this problem.
Yes. Okay, so you can interpret it as differentiating on the parameter and saying that it's... okay, you change infinitesimal. And then you say it's you have an identity between the integrals and gives a... Okay. So one way to do that here is, okay, you put the W on the right, so you say that this integral is equal to 1. Now you put this minus 1, you put on the other side, and it gives you an identity that you can write as, okay, let me use the notation of physicists for expectation. So what does it give? If you differentiate on W, you see that you have one term that goes down, which is the B. And then you have one term that goes down. Okay, and then you can differentiate this determinant. But this D, remind that. Okay, let us use the representation by the sum of spanning trees. So what you see is that in this expression, when you differentiate on W, you can differentiate only once. Because if you differentiate one, then you kill the W term, because it's linear, it's only linear in W. So you will get only the spanning trees that contains the specific. So if you differentiate with respect to W, let's say I naught, G naught, oh, okay, G naught, G1, then you will get only one term, I mean, you will get only the spanning trees that contains this edge. And you can only differentiate once. Okay? Otherwise, you lose the W term. Okay? So now, if you suppose that you differentiate m times, what does it give? It gives an identity. It means that here you can differentiate m times, or you can differentiate m minus 1 times and 1 time of this one. Okay? So it gives you something like B G naught G1 to the M plus, and then there's a minus, okay, you need to think about the minus, but then you have B, you have M possibility to choose the time, the at which time you differentiate the determinant, and then you have B G0 G1 to the M minus 1, and then you have the differentiation of this D. Divided by D, because you want to remultiply to M. And this is equal to 1. Why? Because on the other side, you have exponential of the sum, and it's 1. Okay. So it gives you something like this. And now let me just explain. Okay. So as you will see, it will be difficult to. Okay. It's not possible to explain details. I have no time. In fact, this object, it's possible to interpret it as electrical resistance between two points. Because, okay, that's a rather simple argument. But, and then you get something like that the expectation of this and then you factorize that, you have 1 over b, but this b, you put it in the coefficients, and it gives you something like this. For some conductances, that depends on the B and several things. So that's for coefficient. So that's C, I, J, I naught, G naught. So what does it mean? And this is equivalent conductance. No, OK, resistance, in fact. It's equivalent resistance. Between. G naught G1 for C. Okay? For these conductances that are just a function of the B and okay?
Is it effective resistance?
Yes, that's the effective okay, it's equivalent effective, yes. Thank you. It's better. Okay, that can be interpreted as some effective resistance. Okay, so now let me just sketch the idea. It's less than a sketch, but and you will see that it cannot be very simple, in fact, because. Okay, so this Cij is that this in this term, that's a determinant with these conductances. Okay. But in fact, what you do is you factorize, you have 1 over b, so it will be some function of these conductances and the b I naught g naught g1. Okay, that's a function. Okay. So it's a function of this b g naught g1 and the conductances of the original graph. Okay. So now let me just explain the idea. The idea is that if the if the conductance there is not too big, I mean it's small enough, let's say, then you see that you have B to some power times 1 minus something which is small, let's say epsilon, which is equal to 1. Okay? You say, okay, oh, imagine that we can put that outside of the expectation, then it gives that Bm g naught g1 is smaller than 1 over 1 plus m epsilon. If this resistance is smaller than epsilon. Of course, it's not possible to do that. It's clear that it's not possible. But the idea is that if you have a good control on this conductance, then you can get a control on the B. And now there's a multiscale argument that says, so let me just sketch the multiscale argument. It says that the idea is that if you have a good control, if you have a control on B, ij at some scale, at distance L, let's say, so it means that I minus J is smaller than L, then it gives a control on the resistance at a scale which is a bit larger. L factored 1 plus epsilon. Okay, a bit larger. And by the Vard identity, it says that now if you have a good control of this at scale 1 plus epsilon, then you have a good control on the B at scale 1 plus L 1 plus epsilon. Okay? Okay, that's the standard strategy of multiscale. The thing is that to do this multiscale, you need an identity. And in fact, okay, this identity is not used formally, but you need an inequality that is of this type. Because then you need to put some indicator that this object is not too big. Otherwise, of course, you cannot use this identity. You cannot do that. But that's the general ID. Yes? Okay, at the beginning I wanted to give more details about this proof, but it's okay, I was too optimistic. Do you have questions?
So depend on G naught, no? So
yes, sorry, it depends on G naught G1. It depends on the B and G naught G1. Okay, it's then you have to. In fact, the thing that I don't explain is how you can get from B of this scale to this R at scale a bit, and that's some small trick about the form of the conductances. Okay. But then to make it rigorous, it's quite a pain. Okay, so. So if you are lost now, it's not a problem because I will forget that.
So you know, these multiscale analysis arguments are really hard, even if you have some simple measure like independent random variables, like Wigner matrices or something like that. But here you have a measure that you have almost no tools to control, right? And basically, this is the formula.
That's the yes. The only tool that you have is the identity that comes from, or the inequality that comes from this magical integral. And in fact, you need to prove that it's smaller than one when you put some indicator function. And there, it's very difficult to go without the supersymmetry. You can do it, but it's. It's quite a pain, and it's absolutely not intuitive if you don't have the supersymmetric interpretation, at least now, in the proof of Sartor, Spencer, and Chandler.
So is there a version of this written which doesn't use supersymmetry?
Okay, so in the proof we wrote with De Sertori and Tarras, which is some adaptation of the proof, the initial proof with for via ERRW, we tried to simplify. In fact, we did not really simplify the proof, but we can almost avoid the supersymmetry. Okay, unless at the points where you have the inequality. Okay, we have an argument to avoid it, but it's a bit boring to write it completely, so we didn't do it. Okay, this it's easy to get it without supersymmetry, you just differentiate on the coefficients. But for the inequality with the indicator functions, then it's not easy. Okay, so let's forget about that now, and so I would like to explain now the some relation of with some random Schrödinger operator. So that's a more recent things, and okay, so I will start by a different interpretation of the somehow it's a different interpretation of the Musial mu. So, relation with a random Schrödinger operator. So, so I said that there will be two formulas. So you have the first one, which is the one there, and then I will write the second one, which is closely related to this one, but. Okay, so before I need to fix the one notation, so we start again with, we come back to, we have this graph, still Wij positive. So we always consider that W is fixed for now, and then you take randomness after eventually. So if beta. Okay, so let's introduce beta. So that's a function on the vertices, and you must think at beta as a potential. Okay, so beta will be the potential of some random Schrödinger operator. And then if you have this, then you define h beta. It's 2 beta minus w. So w is just the matrix of okay, if W is equal to 1, it's just the adjacency matrix of the graph. Okay, so it means that this W is the matrix of Wij, and you put 0 when you have no edge. Okay, and this operator, so that's the operator of multiplication by beta. So you think of this as a Schrödinger operator plus a potential. Okay, so up to a constant, it's Laplacian plus potential, so it's a type of it's the type of operators that Simone Wartzel defined.
The weights are all equal here?
The W? No, you don't care. That's general for the moment. So W are general. Okay. And the beta for the moment are not random, but they will be random later. And okay, so now let me make a remark which is related to M matrices or the very classical thing is that if V is finite, just to be sure that you have no problem of definition, and if H beta is positive definite, so it's a symmetric matrix, if it's positive definite, then that's a result of M matrix that if you look at its Green function, then it has positive coefficient. Okay, that's the result of M matrix. What it means that the off-diagonal terms are negative. When you have a matrix such that the off-diagonal terms are negative and the diagonal terms are anything, but and so that the matrix is strictly positive, then in this case, the Green function has positive coefficients. And in fact, it's strictly if the graph is connected. I mean, if the if it's irreducible, if G is connected. Yes? In fact, you can write this gain function, you can write it as a path expansion summing the potentials along the path. Maybe I will write it later. Okay, so once I defined it, then I can write the formula. Excuse me?
Beta was arbitrary.
Yes, beta is arbitrary for the moment, but it will be random, but I will define the measure now. So I will start to give another interpretation of the measure mu in terms of some random Schrödinger operator. So first I need to define a measure. So that work with Tares and Zeng. So I define a measure. So if V is finite, and suppose that you take some positive coefficient theta. Later there will be one, but let me write that strictly positive coefficients on the graph. These are coefficients of the measure, like the W. Then this measure d beta. So that's a measure on the potential. And this measure lives on the set where h beta is strictly positive. And you have a constant. Times exponential minus 1/2. And then you take the scalar product of theta h beta theta divided by square root of the determinant of h beta d beta. Then this is the probability. Except that I forgot some terms. But and then, okay, you have a product of the theta, but that's not so important. Okay. So is it clear what it means? So this defines a measure on the beta. So the beta, there are potentials on the graph. So any potential on the graph. There's no starting point here. It's completely, there's no fixed point. There's no specific point there. And you look at this measure. So this is a measure that lives on the potential such that the Schrödinger operator is strictly positive. Yes? And you have this exponential, which is the quadratic form for this theta, of h beta, and you divide by the square root of the h beta. And it is a probability.
It's a determinant.
Yes, that's the determinant of the h beta, and this is a probability. In fact, you have let me write that you have a more complicated form. Okay, there's a generalization of that, but I will not use it. But you can also add and then you need to add the scalar product theta theta. In fact, there's a more general formula that you can also, you have the quadratic form associated with h beta, but you can also add a second quadratic form associated with the Green function. And you have interaction term between the two, and this is still a probability.
The thetas are parameters here?
Excuse me, the theta are parameters. In fact, it's easy. I write this because this is useful to write the Laplace transform of the beta using the theta, but then it's easy to change the theta into one by changing the W, because you can make a change of variables, and so you can go back to theta equal one, but having the general formula is useful for, okay? Okay, so let's forget that. But the full family is a bit more general than that. So, okay, so that's not completely obvious. It's you can write it by okay. You can write a proof by recurrence on the dimension of the matrix by using Schur complements and so on. Okay. And in fact, let me say that this Letac, okay. We first showed this formula to Letac, and he gave a simpler proof. And in fact, he also remarked that you can generalize the formula. Okay. So there's a contribution of Letac. So let me write. So the beta has some nice properties. So the first thing is that the Laplace transform is explicit. It's not so important, but it's it will be useful to understand the property. Then you have a formula, it's the sum on wij, and then you have square root of 1 plus lambda I, square root 1 plus lambda j minus 1, divided by square root, the product of square root of 1 plus lambda I. Okay, so you have a certain formula for the Laplace transform. It's easy from that to see that, okay, let me say another thing. If theta is equal to 1, it's easy to go to theta equal to 1, then we write just nu W. We forget, okay, this depends on theta, sorry, it's not clear. This depends on theta. When theta is equal to 1, you forget the term, okay? So for theta equal to 1, you can write the Laplace transform, and it has this form. And the consequence of that is that...
Sorry, what's lambda I on the bottom?
That's this lambda. You look at the Laplace transform?
Just the I. Right. Do you mean like product over...
In the graph, yes, because this lambda lives on the vertices of the graph. Excuse me. Ah no, it's not a pi. Sorry, it's a product. It's not as good as LaTeX to make the difference. And okay, so let me state some properties. The main property of interesting property of this beta is that beta is 1 dependent. So there's correlation, of course, between the betas, but the correlation is not that that big. So what does it mean? It means that if you look at the restriction of beta to V1, then it's independent of the restriction of beta to V2 if the distance between in the graph between V1 and V2 is larger than 2. So it means that if you look at two subsets, which have no, you have no edge that cross, that goes between V1 and V2, then the potential between these two are independent. Okay? But nevertheless, it's not a trivial dependence, but it's some type of dependence some type of independence, and it's useful. So you see that compared to the Anderson model, if you imagine that, okay, for the moment it's on finite graph, but it will be possible to do it on infinite graph. And if you compare with the Anderson model is that the potential is IID at each position. Then here you do not have it's not independent, but it's 1 dependent. And okay. So what should I say as? So the second thing is that okay, you can compute the law of the beta, the marginal. It's an inverse Gaussian law if you know what is the inverse Gaussian. Okay, if you don't, it's not so. With some parameters that you can compute, okay? And then there's a last formula is that, okay, something that we will use later, which is a strange property of this graph, is that, okay, suppose that theta is equal to 1. Then in this case, if you look at the Green function at 1 point, then it is independent of the potential on the complement. That's an effect of Schur complement. So you have independence of the potential at one point. With the, if you look at one point, then the green function at this point is independent of the potential outside. And in fact, you know the law. It's always the same. It does not depend on the parameter. It's 1 over 2 gamma, where gamma is a gamma 1 half. OK, it's a bit strange. OK, you need to look at this. OK. The important thing to remember is that we have this potential which has this one dependence. Yes.
I had a question.
Yes.
So this doesn't depend on the edges at all?
Excuse me?
This doesn't depend on the edges at all?
Which one? What?
The properties you just stated.
No, no, it does not depend on
the set of edges.
You mean this one dependence?
Yes.
OK, the one dependence depends on the W in the sense that if you have a, depends whether W is zero or not. But if it's not zero, I mean, you have the graph that, OK, the graph is given by the W. OK, the graph is the graph of the positive W. So it just depends on the structure of the graph in this sense, that whether you have interaction or not between the points. But if you have no interaction, I mean, if you have no connections, no W between two subsets, then you have independence. So it does not depend more on that.
And the fact that the law of the betas is the same as inverse Gaussian?
Yeah, OK, that depends on the parameter. The parameters of the inverse Gaussian depends on the W, on the theta, on yes.
Are these V1 and V2, are those sets of vertices or just vertices?
V1 and V2, they are, okay, sorry. V1 and V2 is a subset of the vertices. See what you ask?
Yes.
Yeah, that's, this lives on the vertices, that's a potential. So you look at the restriction of the potential on subsets of the vertices.
Are they also conditionally independent, given the rest?
Okay, so condition on the boundary, for example, no. But what you can write, in fact, you can say more about that. What you know about that is that you know the law of the restriction, which is of the same type of this family, but you have to add this extra second term. So you can compute the law of the restriction. And in fact, you can compute the law if you have two subsets. If you have U, then you can compute the law of beta conditionally on this complement. It has an explicit form that depends on the Schur complements of the of the potential outside, but you have an explicit law, and it's in the same family. So it means that this potential has the property that it's stable by restriction. This measure, family of measures, is stable by restriction, stable by conditioning by the on the complement of some subset. So you have very good control in this sense that you know exactly what are the restrictions and what are the conditional law. Okay, so let me now explain what's the relation with the the formula out there. So the relation is rather simple. So that's a different interpretation of the, and I will explain why it's useful. So so still V is finite. So what's the relation between this measure and this potential then? It's easy. It's if you suppose that beta follows the law nu vw, so you take theta equal to zero, to one, sorry, normalized, so theta equal to one. Then if you take a fixed point in the graph and you define exponential u I naught j by, you look at g I naught j g beta, so you look at the Green function starting at I naught at position j divided by the Green function at I naught, I naught. So you normalize it. So you look at the function on the vertex that depends. OK, that's the starting point. And you look at the function on the vertex normalized so that its value is equal to 1 at I naught. OK, so it means that u is equal to 0 at I naught. OK, Then in this case, the relation with that is that if you look at this U I naught dot, then it follows the law mu I naught W that I defined there. So if you look at this, somehow it's the green function, but normalized to have value 0, to have value 1 at the origin, then it corresponds to the to the original measure. Okay, so that's, in fact, the correspondence is rather simple, and in fact it seems that it's maybe a standard operation in random Schrödinger. That's what Simone told me. I will explain. So it means in terms of the VRJP, it means that the VRJP starting at I naught has the following property that it is a mixture. You can interpret it as that, as 1 over Wij G I naught J divided by G I naught I. Okay, so the jumping rate, they can be expressed in terms of the Green function, and the starting point in this case appears as the first position of the Green function. Yes, so the starting point of the process, it appears by the choice of the first point of the Green function. Okay, and now so let me say the proof is simple. I mean, it's computation, but the proof, obviously, the proof is you make a change of variable. And in fact, it seems that this change of variable already appears in a work, at least in the works of that's Simone Wartzel that told me that in Kunz-Souillard. So for random Schrödinger operator, they did the same thing. If you have a random Schrödinger operator, then you can construct this, and you want to look at the. So this defines some field, and you want to make the change of variable to have the law of the fields. The problem is that in general, it's not easy to use. In this case, it's more or less, it's the reverse. We started by the field that appeared in this business of reinforcement on the MOOC, and we got back to the potential. So somehow we did the reverse, but it's natural to look at both somehow, because the field is easier to analyze the asymptotic behavior and localization delocalization behavior, and the potential in fact will be easier for other things. Okay, so let me make one remark. So what's the point of this potential? There's one important remark, is that compared to the law that is defined above, then you see that in the definition of beta, you had no reference to the starting point. Yes, the beta does not depend on the starting point. The starting point appears by the point at which you look at the Green function. Yes, so it means that you have a way to couple all these measures starting from different points, because this measure was defined depending on the starting point. But what it means is that all these measures are somehow coupled by this double, just by this beta. So it means that the measure from the process starting from different points are coupled by this beta. In fact, the beta has one more dimension. If you look at this at the measure lives on RV, and this one lives on RV minus 1. So there's an extra dimension, and this extra dimension allows to couple all the thing. Okay, so it gives a coupling of the of the measures mu IV. Mu I W for different W. Okay.
Just theta equals 1, right?
Excuse me?
Just theta equals 1.
Yeah, it's theta equal 1. Yes. It's theta equal 1. Okay, so for, ah, yes, yes. Okay, so now, so what's this good for? So let me explain what you can do with that. So now I will explain. Okay, so what is it good for? In fact, the main interest of this representation is to extend the representation of the process on infinite graphs. So if you think about the measure there, the initial measure, the mixing measure, is defined for finite graphs. And it's not an easy job to extend it to infinite graphs, because you have strong, it's non-local measure, because you have the square root of the determinant. And so you have no Gibbs argument to extend it in a good way. So you can take weak limits, but with weak limits, you can do almost nothing. So you have no ergodicity of the limits, no. And this representation by the beta, it will be good to give a representation of the process on the infinite graph. So the aim now is to give a similar formula as this one. So you would like to represent the process on the infinite so now you would like to extend this representation by the green function, but on infinite graphs. And that's where there are subtleties that depends on the fact that the work is transient or not, and it will be and the transience of the process will be related to the existence of delocalized state or not, of one delocalized state at the bottom of the spectrum. So let me make a remark: is that all what we do is at the bottom of the is somehow okay. It's not at the bottom of the spectrum here, but when the graph okay, I will make a remark later. Excuse me?
A measure you just erased on new beta, can you define it on infinite graph?
Yes, that's what I'm going to do. Okay, you cannot write the measure like this, but you can take a Kolmogorov extension of the measure, and it will converge to some random process. In fact, what you do, since you have one dependence, then it's not surprising that you can extend it to infinite graphs. So now I will explain how to So B, let's say, so extension to infinite graph. So we'd like to first extend the beta to infinite graphs, and more important, to extend this representation. So to give a good meaning of the Green function on the infinite graph. So somehow we'd like to take the limit of these green functions and to understand how they are, what they are on the infinite graph. Okay. So the key thing here is to take. Okay. So the first step is simple. You take some increasing boxes. So suppose that you are on ZD, okay, to simplify, and you take Vn, which are the boxes of size n, any box, yes? So the first thing, of course, is to define it by approximation, but the important point is to choose a good boundary condition. And in fact, the good boundary condition is not the obvious one where you just cut the box. The good boundary condition is the wired boundary condition. So what does it mean? It means that you take an extra point delta n, and you suppose that this point delta n is connected to the box by all the edges that connect the box to the complement. Yes? So that's the classical wired boundary condition. So it means that all the edges that exit, you have the box. You look at the edges that exit the box, and then you consider that all the edges are connected to an extra point with the same weight as the initial edges. Yes? So it means that somehow you glue all the edges outside of the box to one point. So that's the wired boundary condition. And so we define Gn, okay, G theta n. That's this wired graph. Okay, that's with boundary wired boundary condition. And the thing is that with this condition, so if you have this graph, then you can define the beta on this graph. The beta is defined on any graph, so you can define beta n the beta on the wired graph. Yes. And the thing that is that this one has a good compatibility property. So first step is to remark, that's simple, that if you look at beta n plus 1, but you restrict it to Vn, then it has the same law as beta n restricted to Vn. So remind that beta n is not defined on Vn, it's defined on Vn plus the delta n. Okay? But it means that if you have two boxes, but if you look at this one restricted to this box or this one restricted to this box, then they have the same law. Okay? And that's very easy from the Laplace transform that I wrote. You just write the Laplace transform and it's almost obvious. Okay? So it means that by Kolmogorov extension, then by Kolmogorov, it means that there exists, you can define beta on the full graph, on the infinite graph.
Is it true for any graph or just for ZB?
No, it's true for, that's completely general. No. That any graph, you take a finite approximation, you take a wired thing, and then it's stable. Yeah, I just tried ZD to have a picture, but nothing depends now on the graph. So you can define by Kolmogorov beta on the infinite graph such that the beta restricted to Vn is equal to the beta n in low to the Vn. Okay, so that's the first thing. Now the more difficult thing is to extend the Green function. Okay, so so now you define Gn, that's the Green function on.
Yeah, I don't even know any other statistical physics model that has this property.
What? Of compatibility?
Consistency, yeah. Monotonicity you have for spanning trees, for example.
Yes, it's because somehow the beta are local functions. They are not the full. If you look at the field, yes, yeah. Anderson is IID, so it works. No, but if you look at the fields, then you don't have this property. Okay, so so the question now is, you look at the Green function on the graph, on the wired graph, and you would like to understand what is its limit, because the if you understand what is the limit of the Green function, then you will be able to understand how to represent the process on the infinite graph. And that's where there's a dichotomy between the recurrence and the transient case that appears. So you have the Green function. So imagine that you have two points inside the box, I and j. Then, okay. So let me say one word. There's always a representation of the Green function as a sum on paths. In fact, you can write the Green function as a sum on all paths from I to j of the product of the W divided by the product of the beta. In fact, you can you can say that it's if you have a path, you have 1 over beta 0, sigma 0, sigma 1, 1 over beta, sigma 1, etc., beta, sigma 1, sigma 2, etc. So you have a representation in sum of paths of the Green function. Okay. So now there's a useful decomposition, which is in fact classical, is that what you want to do is to decompose this Green function in the sum of paths that remains inside the box that don't touch the extra points, and then you have the path that goes to delta n, and then they make some loops at delta n, and they goes back to j. Okay, so you have a decomposition of the Green function in two parts: the part which correspond to paths that are localized inside the box, and the path that goes to the extra point. So it gives two terms. One, it's this gn hat of plus. You have two things that I will write: psi n of I, which correspond to the path that goes to delta n. Then you have gn of delta n delta n, which correspond to the loops there, times psi n of j. Okay, and now it's not difficult to see that the psi n of I, it corresponds to the mixing measure. Okay, what does it mean? The psi n of I, which corresponds to the sum on paths that goes to delta n, it corresponds to the mixing measure, the VRJP starting from the point delta n. So if you look at the VRJP that start from infinity somehow, so it's mean this extra point, then it has a mixing measure, and this mixing measure corresponds to this psi n. Okay, and you so it means that you have two terms in this formula, and the point is to make this converge. And now the step three. Okay, so it's a bit fast, but the step three is that this gn ij, it's increasing in n, just because it's the sum of paths that are localized inside the box. So if you increase the size of the box, it's localized. It increases because it's positive terms. So this one is increasing. Now the difficult part is this psi n. And the key property, which is the key to everything, in fact, is that the psi n has a property of martingale. And that's a bit the magic of the model, is that this psi n, which corresponds to somehow the mixing field of this VRJP, it's a martingale for the filtration generated by the beta inside the box. Okay, so it means that it converges almost surely because it's positive. So psi n I converges to some psi of I. Okay, and now there's this last term. And by some miracle, this last term is independent of the rest, and it's 1 over 2 gamma. So now let me state the main result. Okay, so before... okay. So that with Zeng. Says that okay, so it means that the gn, it converges, gn ij, it converges almost surely to gn ij plus an independent random variable which has this gamma as a gamma 1/2 times some function and so what should I write now is that should say something on that is that first the fact that psi is equal to zero. So in fact, it's easy to see when you have ergodicity, like in Z, it's easy to see that either psi is strictly positive everywhere, or almost surely, or it's zero almost surely. Okay? And the fact that it's zero is equivalent to the fact that the VRJP is recurrent. Okay? So in the transient case, it means that you have some psi. And the second point is that it's easy to see by construction that the psi is a generalized eigenfunction. It's an extended state. Sorry. Of h beta, in the sense that h beta psi is equal to zero, and in fact you have polynomial control on the growth of psi. So it's what is called okay, it's that standard term for extended state. And this this g hat, it corresponds to the Green function of the of h beta in some classical sense. This g hat of beta, it's the limit of h beta plus epsilon minus 1. Okay, you look at the potential plus epsilon and you take the limit as epsilon tends to 0. So it's the natural Green function on the infinite graph. Okay. So the conclusion of that is, finally, is a mixture of Markov jump process with jumping rate given by this formula. Okay, so okay, if I have 2 minutes. Conclusion of that is that. So you have a representation of the process on infinite graphs in terms of this Green function. Okay, so you see that the surprising thing is that you have an extra random variable 1 over 2 gamma, which is completely independent of the potential. In fact, the 1 over 2 gamma is independent of the potential. And in terms of the process, you have an equivalence between the fact that this psi is equal to zero and the fact that the VRJP is recurrent. Okay. And okay, let me say that from this property, with the estimate of Merkle and Rolles, okay, this implies, in particular, that the ERRW is recurrent in dimension 2. With the estimates of Merkle and Rolles. Just to say in few words, you have this representation above. Somehow the estimates of Merkle-Rolles says that you have polynomial decrease of the G. And the polynomial decrease of the G is not compatible with the fact that you have a component psi which will be stationary and ergodic. Because it means that the Gn will be larger than this psi. And this psi is stationary and ergodic. And it's not possible to have a polynomial decrease and to be stationary and ergodic. So it means that the psi must be zero if you have. So it means that as soon as you have polynomial decrease, then you are recurrent. Even if you don't know whether you are positive recurrent, you know that you are recurrent. Okay. And okay, so let me now. What?
Itself by definition is stationary.
No, the G is not stationary. In fact, the G is not stationary because it depends on the first point. I mean, it's stationary in terms of the 2 point. No, it's stationary in terms of the 2 point. But if you want to, in general, what you look at is you fix this I naught, and you want to understand the field in the second coordinate. So it means that it's not stationary in the second coordinate. But you have one component which is stationary in the second coordinate, which is the psi. So it means that somehow you have in this representation you have two terms. You have one term that corresponds to the transient, which corresponds to the psi, which is the extended state, which corresponds somehow to the this psi is the mixing measure of the process starting from infinity somehow because it's constructed as the limit of this. So this psi corresponds to the mixing measure of the process that would start from very far. And in this representation, you have two terms. You have term The G hat corresponds to the process condition to be recurrent somehow. Okay, you can make it precise, but and let me okay. Let
that gives you something about the sum of the two. Right?
Excuse me.
Sum of the G and the phi psi. That's what Merkle-Enrolles controls.
Yes, Merkle-Enrolles they control something like exponential of G naught J divided by G I naught to some power 1/4. And they have polynomial decrease of that. But in fact, from that, you can prove that it's not possible to have something below which is stationary. It's rather easy argument, but okay. Can I take just 1 minute to comment on the meaning in terms of spectral theory, which is something I don't understand. So if you look at the infinite graph, so you have this Schrödinger operator on the infinite graph, H beta. So it's positive or null. So you see that the spectrum is included in R plus. I'm pretty sure that it's equal to R plus, but we didn't prove it, that the spectrum. At least we know that we have the accumulation of the eigenfunction at zero. And what we proved there is that if the VRGP is transient, which can be the case, then you have one delocalized state at the origin, which of course does not give any information on the nature of the spectrum on any interval. So the question now is, we don't know whether in the case the VRGP is transient, then you have delocalization on some interval at the bottom of the spectrum or not. And let me make a second remark, is that there's something surprising compared to Anderson localization, is that in general, at the edge of the spectrum, you should have localization. And here, it seems to be the contrary. But there's one good reason for that, is that the way the eigenvalue accumulates at the bottom of the spectrum is not as for Anderson. For Anderson, there should be Lifshitz tail, so it means that the number of eigenstate at the origin should be exponentially small. And here it's the contrary. In fact, you have some accumulation of the eigenvalue at the origin. This means so how can you see that? Is that the Green function at the origin? It's 1/2 gamma, where gamma is a gamma 1/2. So it means that the probability that the Green function at the origin is larger than t, it has a tail which is t 1/2. So this is not standard for Schrödinger, because normally you have something which is a tail 1/T. So you have more, it means that you have more eigenvalues close to the bottom of the spectrum than you should have for standard Anderson model inside, in the bulk. Okay, so there's a concentration of eigenvalues at the origin. Okay, but we don't know whether we don't know what should be the, it's not clear what it should be at the bottom. We don't know if it's a special effect of the origin, or if there's a, we don't know if the delocalization at the bottom means that there's localization in small interval or not. Okay, sorry, I'm late.
Okay, thank you.
Are there questions on this lecture or previous lectures?
So, is this one dependent thing?
Yes.
Does it also hold for three sets of vertices?
For?
Three sets of vertices.
What do you mean, three sets of vertices?
So V1, V2?
Yes. It's completely... any subset that have no, any family of subset that have no connection, it's the thing which is not clear is that, okay, I think it's not, the beta are not a function on independent function on the edges, because it's easy to create one dependent potential by taking a function of, if you take independent random variable on the edges and you take a function of these of the neighboring edges, then it's one dependent. That's obvious. But I think it's not this type of one dependent. I don't think that it's a function of independent variables on the edges. I mean, I have no proof of that. But at least.
The other thing is, these betas are just supported on, they just have to be greater than the degrees, right? That's all.
Yes.
Or greater than the degrees over 2.
No. They can be smaller. So it means that this is not a Markov operator. So if you look at Laplacian plus, okay, you can center so that you have Laplacian. Uh-huh. So it means that if you imagine that you have the standard Laplacian W equal 1, then you could look at plus the minus Laplacian, okay? But this can be positive or negative. Two beta minus d, that's the diagonal of the matrix of the Laplacian. So you put the Laplacian now to have a probabilistic interpretation. Then the thing is that this can be either positive or negative. So in this sense, it's not Markov operator. Because the potential is not positive. If you write it in probabilistic term, it's not positive.
You take the Laplacian and put on and you subtract the negative diagonal. Won't be positive anymore.
Okay, this one is positive or negative. Okay.
The Laplacian is okay, the minus the Laplacian is positive.
Okay, I should write plus. Sorry. That's a plus.
So it's a positive Laplacian.
Yes, let's say it's a probabilistic Laplacian.
Positive Laplacian.
That's the positive Laplacian. So you have 2D on the diagonal.
If you add positive things to the diagonal, of course it will be positive that way.
No, this is positive definite. No. What I mean is that this can be negative. So what I mean is that if you want to have a probabilistic interpretation, in general you have Laplacian plus V, where V is positive.
Yes.
Because that's a killing rate to the to yes, the yes. What I mean is that this Hamiltonian is not of this type. Because the V can be a negative or positive. So in probabilistic term, it means that they can be killing or creation uh-huh. in your operator. So it's not a probabilistic operator. It's not.
So you're saying even if you subtract something from some diagonals, it can still be a positive definite?
Yes, it can be still positive definite. Uh-huh. Yeah, the thing is that's why the beta needs to be correlated somehow. Because it can be positive.
You can have Schrödinger potentials, Schrödinger operators with where the potential becomes negative, but the spectrum is positive.
That's possible.
Yes, but if you put a negative term, then you need to compensate it by a positive term elsewhere. That's why you have at least one dependence on the beta.
Okay.
Otherwise, it would not work.
A question? If I have a question. You conditioned the construction of beta, the measure on beta, on the fact that H beta was positive.
Yes.
But here it appears that for all choices of beta, or at least maybe almost surely, the spectrum goes down to 0.
Yes.
I mean, for me, it's not obvious. I mean, you condition on the fact that H beta was a positive measure, a positive operator, it could
yes.
be strictly positive. I mean, there's no reason why it should go down to 0.
Actually, we didn't prove that that the spectrum. We didn't compute the spectrum.
No, but here, if you find this, in the transient case, if you find this extended yes. state at 0,
yes.
the spectrum
yes.
goes down to 0.
Yes.
So it's not the operator. It's not strictly.
His definition was for actually finite volume.
Yes. Okay.
That's for finite volume. But if you look, you integrate and then you see that you have 1 over square root of the determinant. So you want to put eigenvalues at the bottom somehow. Actually, there's no reason not to put eigenvalues at the bottom.
But for the finite matrices, I don't expect H beta to have a spectrum going down to 0.
What I mean is that for finite graph, of course, H beta is strictly positive. But if you look at the distribution of the eigenvalues, then you see that the Green function is always 1 over 2 gamma. So it means that it has the tail t to the minus 1 half. So the probability to find an eigenfunction which is close to the bottom, to 0, mm-hmm. is large. I mean, it's larger than if you take a Schrödinger operator on a box where it's 1 over t, mm-hmm. the probability to find in a small interval of size t.
Yes. So when your graph is a tree, do you understand the betas?
Better? Or when it's aligned?
In fact, the strange thing is that, when it's a tree, Yes. When it's a tree, then in this case, it's a sum of independent things. That's the one correlation is simple. Okay. So in the case when it's a tree, then what you have is that beta I, it's the sum ug minus ui. That's a general formula. But in this case, in the case of the tree, these things are independent. The gradients of this u are independent. So in this case, it's a sum of independent things on the edges. So these things live on the edges, and the beta is a sum of independent things on the edges, which explains the one dependence. But except from that, you understand the beta, but in fact, the representation you get by the thing that you have on tree does not correspond to the representation you get there. So there's a strange thing. There's two different representations on trees. Okay. But